It's been important ever since December 2000. I've been out of federal prison for over 15 years now. And thank you. The moment I stepped out of prison and I got home, I would have these crying spells because I knew that it should have been more of us that went home. I had a sense of like survivor's guilt because I'm gonna try to kind of have some organization in speaking today without getting too emotional, but like Dan said, since my release, there have been other parents that have been vocal about their child being incarcerated under federal drug sentencing and mandatory minimum sentencing. And out of all the people that I know that receive commutations with a drug case, much less a crack cocaine case, I don't know anyone who just served 6.5 years in federal prison and had a president sign a document that was basically a get out of jail card. And so with that adage to much is given, much is required, because it wasn't something that just miraculously happened. There were several organizations, individual people, students who rallied behind the cause of freeing Kemba Smith. But it was more than just helping my parents get their only child home or feeling sorry for me. It was the fact that the fastest growing population within prison were Black women, and that I was a first-time nonviolent drug offender. And so people and organizations had thought that my case would set a precedent for other cases, but unfortunately, the only source of relief that I had after exhausting all of the remedies within the court system was executive clemency. So in coming out, I couldn't just move on with my life and forget about all of those people that deserved a second chance too. So ever since my release, I've been speaking out for those who are still in prison. And so I'm gonna talk about some of my journey, but I do wanna play a video because I think it's important for you all to see a visual, because Dan had the opportunity to hear my dad speak, but to actually see me in federal prison is another thing. Initially, when I went into the prison system, well, let me back up. Okay, so what led me down this path? I was a student at Hampton University. Basically, I was excited to be at a historically Black university because I grew up in predominantly white areas and going to school. And so I decided to go have this Black college experience. And I say this because I was excited. The first and only thing that was on my mind when I got to college, when I got on campus at Hampton University, was, oh my goodness, look at all these fine Black guys. Because I had never been around an environment where it was just so many fine guys. And so I had it in my mind, you know, this is the school for me. I didn't care what I was going to major in, what Hampton was good at. I just knew that's where I wanted to be. But understand, what happened to me at Hampton could have happened to me at Columbia University. My son is at Washington and Lee University, which I'll share with you about him, but they had a big drug bust on their campus about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, so I don't want you all to think that this is something that just happens on HBCU campuses. But basically, I saw this drug dealer who would come on campus, he would pick up upperclassmen girls, and I would just kind of wonder who this guy was, because he would come on campus in different cars, and when he would come around the student, at that time, that small little building was a student union, and student grow where people hung out, but he would park his car in front of that area and guys would come up to his car and talk to him, and I would see him and I just wondered, you know, who is this guy? Why is he always on campus in different cars? And in my freshman year, my roommate at the time, she dated a drug dealer, and I remember her coming into the dorm room, new coach bag, new shoes, and I kind of wondered, you know, what that experience was like. But then when I went to a house party one night at my big brother's house, I told you I'm an only child, so he was a play big brother on campus. And so I met Peter. And one of the things that I dealt with starting out college was having low self-esteem and feeling as if I wasn't pretty enough, trying to fit in. I didn't, you know, seek out student organizations to kind of try to fit in. I just wanted to be a part of the cool kids on campus. But basically, when Peter noticed me and started talking to me, it gave me this warm, fuzzy feeling inside, like, oh my gosh, she's actually talking to me. And then eventually when I went back on campus, the girls came into my dorm room and they were just like, girl, what was he like? What were you all talking about? And for that moment, I felt like people were really paying attention to me. And so had I loved me the way that I needed to, maybe it wouldn't have meant anything to me, but eventually Peter and I had these continued interactions, and eventually, I'm just sharing bits and pieces. He told me what it was that he did. I'm not one of those people that have been incarcerated to say, oh, I didn't do anything wrong, or I didn't know what he was doing, but basically, he told me what it was that he did and how he didn't like selling drugs and some of his ideas as far as moving into the business world. And so I know none of you young ladies or more mature ladies in the room have ever felt this way, but basically I thought to myself, well, maybe if I stay with him, maybe I can help change him or influence him to live a legal lifestyle. Even though Gus and Odessa did not send me to Hampton University to convert from drug dealer thug into being a law-abiding citizen, somewhere along the way, I got that thing mixed up. But, you know, I share this aspect of my story mostly with young people to try to prevent them from making certain choices. But eventually, that relationship that I was in turned quickly into a violent, abusive relationship. And that's one of the things that was talked about in the video as well. And so the first time Peter put his hands on me, I actually thought he was going to kill me and thought that my parents were going to read about me in the Philadelphia Inquirer because we were out of town at the time. And so eventually, fast forwarding, he eventually killed his best friend because he thought his best friend was cooperating with authorities. At that particular time, I couldn't believe that I was actually with someone who had taken another person's life. And so it came a point in time where the federal government wanted him, and because I was his girlfriend at the time, they wanted me to give them him on a silver platter. And for me, I just basically went in and talked to the agents. I was very intimidated because it was about 8 federal agents in a room, and I went in the room and told them everything that Peter had instructed me to tell them. And so after that, Peter told me that he wanted me to meet him in Houston, Texas. And I met him in Houston, Texas. We went from Houston, Texas to San Diego, California, to Arizona, and then the last city was Seattle, Washington. And I don't want you all to think that I was this drug dealer's girlfriend. We were going from city to city, living the life of luxury. Basically, all the money had run out, and he was driving from city to city in a U-Haul truck and basically pawning odd items in that U-Haul truck in order to survive. And so when we lived in Houston, Texas, we were living in the Third Ward. Anybody familiar with the Third Ward in Houston? It's not a not-so-safe area. So there were bars on the windows, bars on the door, roaches crawling around an apartment. And then when we lived in Seattle, Washington, I remember where there were a couple of nights we didn't know where we were going to get our next meal from.